subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, suppose even the occasion arises where the use of force or going to the battle is necessary. What are the qualifiers for that? What kind of conduct did the Prophet, peace be upon him, teach us? First of all, intention. In a clear hadith, he indicated that those who go to the battlefield for the sake of economic gains, as symbolized by war spoils, or today going to the battlefield hiding behind titles like terrorism, whereas it may be ideally or originally for oil or natural gas, or extending markets, globalizing at the expense of the poor. The intent cannot be economic. Then the Prophet ﷺ, you see, even though he used different terms, but when you compare it with today's world, it's so beautiful and so comprehensive. And then he said that clearly that those who fight for asabiyya, power, my people right or wrong, blind nationalism, that if my country is going to to be engaged in an immoral war that displeases Allah, I shouldn't question. I must follow, otherwise I will not be patriotic. No. The law of Allah is above the law of men. Asabiyya, which was the reason why people killed each other in pre-Islamic Arabia, for no reason except that you have to follow the troops, you have to follow your tribe or clan. That's forbidden. That's the equivalent today of this narrow nationalism. Our country, the greatest, let's crush everybody else and bring them under our...
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Then he said also those who fight for personal reputation, to be called courageous, he's not fighting in the way of Allah. What did he say then? Only those who fight are fighting so that the word of Allah becomes supreme are doing that fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah. What does it mean word of Allah becomes supreme? Forcing Islam on everybody's throat? No. Word of Allah being supreme in the context of relationship with others is that you cannot go to war or fight unless there is aggression or oppression, at least in the relational aspect of the statement. But then the Prophet ﷺ goes beyond niyya, and Muslim jurists have uniformly agreed that you cannot declare jihad without some legitimate authority. It doesn't have to be a government, by the way. For example, when the Soviet Union, or more correctly Soviet disunion, invaded Afghanistan, the government itself was a puppet government. It was a communist government placed there by the Russians. Obviously you cannot stop resisting the brutality of the Russian army because there is no Muslim government to declare. So the legitimate authority in that case perhaps was the scholars and the leaders of tribes who decided that we have to stand up for our right and against even the puppet government as well. It has to be the last resort. And anyone who honestly studies the teaching of the Quran, the Sunnah, and the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ, that he was never anxious to solve problems only in the battlefield. Every attempt were made to resolve things peacefully, but justly as well. A lot of people today keep talking about peace, 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 peace. But they seldom speak about the twin of peace, justice. Usually I tell audience when we speak about the issue of Palestine, occupied Palestine, I said, yes, the Israelis, the Zionists, are very interested in peace, not only peace, pieces, because they spell peace, P-I-E-C-E. So they're very interested in taking one piece of land after the other to make illegal settlement. No wonder they're interested in peace, the peace of the thief, or the pieces that they are confiscating one after the other. Why not? But once you raise the issue of justice, oh, that's terrorism. And the terrorists are called the men of peace by the hypocritical big powers of the world. Those who legitimately resist and defend their rights that's taken away from them are called terrorists, and war criminals are called men of peace. What a hypocrisy, and what an upside down value system. It has to be the last resort. In the Quran, especially in Surah Al-Anfal, Surah number 8, It says that even in the middle of the battle, when no means of peaceful and just solution could be arrived at, and then it has to be the last resort. In the Quran, especially in Surah Al-Anfal, Surah number 8, it says that even in the middle of the battle, when no means of peaceful and just solution could be arrived at, and there is initiative towards peace, you should be inclined to peace. Because the idea is not just more killing, but the minimum use of force to restore justice. وَإِنْ جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَىٰ. If they're inclined to peace, you should be inclined to peace. One of the most noble statements that you can find anywhere, I couldn't find any equivalent really, that even in the middle of the battlefield, if one of those enemies seek refuge in you, give them refuge so that they may hear the word of Allah. وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. It's very clear. Which shows that the idea is not killing, but once he hears the word of Allah, maybe his enmity might be removed and there would be no reason for conflict and fight. That the best solution for that is just to resolve this or deal with that hatred that's emanating not from Muslim but from others who are committing aggressive fights against them. The Prophet, peace be upon him, and his companions after him, the Khulafa, were very clear about sparing non-combatants. He said, don't hurt a woman, a child, a monk or clergy devoting themselves for religious life, what we call today non-combatant, people who are not carrying arms or representing danger to you. Refraining from destruction, not even killing animals except for food, not destroying and burning, as we have seen in the so-called civilized world, using the most devastating weapons of mass destruction. And mass destruction doesn't mean only the three: biological, nuclear and chemical. There are equally devastating weapons of mass destruction that have been used to kill thousands and thousands of innocent people. Yet the biggest hypocrisy in the world today, that they say, oh, we have to prevent this or that country from weapons of mass destruction, and turn back and use the same weapons of mass destruction or similar weapons of mass destruction to kill thousands of people. What a hypocrisy. They're lecturing everyone, and they better put their own homes in order. This is the double standard that's pervading the world today. The Prophet ﷺ taught also humane treatment of the injured, because they're not capable of endangering your life, of the prisoners of war, no matter how, what crime they committed. In some cases, some prisoners of war were treated in a way that the humane societies, the animal protection societies, would have protested because of that brutality of the so-called civilized world that's lecturing everyone how to behave. But then we go on to a couple of other areas that, especially after September 11, we heard many radio programs, television programs, writings, articles. But then we go on to a couple of other areas that, especially after September 11, we heard many radio programs, television programs, writings, articles, popular articles, quasi-scholarly articles, all aimed at proving that, no, there is violence also in the Quran. So you ask them, like what? Jihad has been cleared. That's the most important issue of attack. But before I get into this, let me sum up for you the number of methodological errors in these interpretations. And then when I deal, inshallah, with some of these examples, as much as time allows, I hope, inshallah, you'll be able to see for yourself what type or types of errors are involved in this distortion of the message of the Quran, mainly by non-Muslims, but honestly by some Muslims also. Why? The biggest problem is to let emotions and historical legacy blind the person from seeing the objective truth. And there's no question that there have been legacy of cooperation, but also legacy of conflict between the Muslim world and the West. And sometimes there are stereotypes on both sides, to be honest. So one has to overcome that and see what exactly is the message of the Quran. Secondly, sometimes people do not give priority to the only two primary sources of Islam, the Quran and Sunnah. Both are based on revelation. The Quran and sound Sunnah are the only two primary sources that are based on revelation that no human being can supersede. Nobody can replace an ayah or a sound hadith. And instead, People look at action of some Muslims and equate it with Islam, which is false. Muslims are human beings, even if they're devoted Muslims. Even with good intention, people make right decision or wrong decision, it should not be counted against Islam. Should be clear. But in some cases also we find a number of technical errors, and I'm not going to question motives. In some cases it's deliberate distortion, in some cases it could be lack of sufficient and authentic information.